be if you want to live.
You just don't turn it off!
What is up, guys? Welcome back to the channel. This is Backtrack Cinema. My name is Jason. This is where we talk movies of the past that you know and love. And welcome to my man and a movie watch party series I've been doing since January. This is the last episode of what I like to call season one. And I got a totally rad individual. I got Garrett from Born to Be Rad. You guys love his channel. I love his channel. So everyone, welcome to the show. And Garrett, how are you, buddy?
Good, man. I'm the season finale, dude.
Heck yeah, I didn't know that.
Wow. And this,
you know, I probably could have done a few more, but I wanted to. I got other things to do and other content to get going, so I thought I'd just end this off with Back to the Future.
Dude, I mean, what a banger to kind of end this thing off it. And you know, when you asked me to come on and talk about a movie, I was like, oh man, Back to the Future. How can I say no? It's literally my favorite movie of all time. And man, I'm so excited to kind of rewatch it because I've never done a commentary for it. So, you know, I always kind of watch it with myself or friends or whatever. But now we can kind of just chat through it and talk about some cool stuff that, you know, we remember, our favorite parts, or maybe even things about the movie that the other people don't know. I'm sure you're full of, you know, inside info on some stuff that maybe I don't even remember. But I'm excited to come here, man. I was, you know, I wanted to support you. So I wore your shirt tonight for you. You know, I wanted to get in your good graces tonight, and hopefully you guys in the chat have a fun, rad time.
Yeah, well, dude, I mean, our channels are very different, but the fact that we love the 80s is where we hit home, I think. So 100%. I like what you do. I like what Mel does. I haven't familiarized myself with your third rad pack, Justin, but yeah. I definitely got to check him out, too. But Mel is the first person I met. She was on my old channel, actually. We did a stream on my old channel. I rebranded this one.
Oh, wait. Did you guys do Lost Boys or no?
We did our top 10 vampire films.
Oh, that was because her doing something on someone's channel for Lost Boys a long time ago, kind of when I first met her.
Yeah. So I was the J-Man's Movie Cave, and then I rebranded to Backtrack Cinema. And yeah, it's going well, man. Talking old movies. I like it. That's my zone.
Yeah.
So and this is I recently heard Michael J. Fox in an interview say that, you know, you had to have talent in the 80s.
I just saw harder. That. I was going to say
and
that.
I go, you know what? He's not fucking wrong.
He's not wrong, dude.
He's not wrong.
100% not wrong. And it's only going to get worse because, you know, a lot of the people they're going to nitpick for movies are probably people they're going to find that have big social media followings and throw them in a movie being like, well, if these guys are in here, then that's a sure thing. People will watch it, right? Instead of actually creating talented like people, right? So again, a lot of these people on the socials could be talented and all, but I mean, it was a grueling process back then, I think, for some of these people to really come out and outshine these people. It wasn't just like, hey, someone found me and here's a job. It was like, you know, it was grueling. Like, I mean, when you talk about Michael J. Fox, we were just talking about a little bit ago before we came on, and you said you rewatched some Family Ties. And man, when he did this movie, he was doing Family Ties, Teen Wolf, and Back to the Future all at the same time. I mean, how can you even expect that from a kid his age to do those three movies simultaneously and really even understand like how the characters, right? Like, how confusing must that be if you're doing like a show during the day or whatever, and then you're going to Teen Wolf, and then you're doing Back to the Future at night? Like, it just must have been insane for him.
And top it all, like, he did Family Ties during the day. He would be shooting Back to the Future at night, which is why a lot of it was filmed at night. And because that's the only way they could loan him out,
right?
And and you watch Family Ties, Alex Keaton is nothing like Marty McFly. Alex Keaton is a Republican. He wants to just be rich. He's almost a cold kind of, not a cold character, but that's what his arc is in that show, is that he learns about friendships and dating and all the stuff that he goes through, but he wants to just work on Wall Street and be the guy after the money. And he picks on his sisters and all that, but nothing like Marty McFly. Not the rock and roll, and roll 80s kid completely. So how he switched, but he also said that was the toughest part of it.
I can imagine. And you said you were rewatching it. I said, I haven't seen Family Size since it aired. And I was a little kid and I remember just loving it because I was a big Michael J. Fox fan. That the first movie I ever saw him in, it might've been Family Ties first, but then I saw Teen Wolf before I saw Back to the Future. So that's kind of how it all went for me. So between the three, I was all in on Michael J. Fox. And like I said, watching Family Ties just to see Michael J. Fox, I loved it. But I'm like, you know what? I do need to rewatch that because I guarantee there's so much of like what that was really about that I never really understood as a kid. I was probably only, I don't know, maybe like 7 or 8 years old when I saw that for the first time.
And so, you know who's in it too as his sister's boyfriend? Scott Valentine. From My Demon Lover, it plays Nick.
Yeah. That is so crazy, right?
Yeah, and you'll see people like Gina Davis, Tom Hanks is in the first season. So that'd be 1982. So cool, and he's like a drunk, he's the drunk uncle. But
yeah, I gotta Michael J. Fox, go back and watch it.
Yeah, he acts his ass off in that. There's some episodes that just really pull on your heartstrings. Especially the final episode.
Wasn't he very active in that too? Like as far as like his performance, like he was always jumping around and like he was very animated.
Yeah.
Is that what?
Yeah,
that
very animated. Where he starts dating his wife, like who his wife is now. Mm-hmm. She's his girlfriend, and the chemistry between them is great. And then a few seasons later, he starts dating Courtney Cox, comes in. And it's almost like they have no chemistry. It's kind of strange. Like
that is interesting.
But yeah, definitely. I'm still complimenting doing a review on it, like the whole series, like just kind of browsing through it.
Anything Michael J. Fox is good. So I would say you should go for it.
Yeah, for sure. Actually, Teen Wolf was my very, very first review on this channel. First review. Anyways, I want to address the chat and then we'll get your guys' movies ready and we'll get going here. So, Gabe Trek's films, one of the greatest films of all time. I will not disagree with that. Timothy says, watch it on my Blu-ray. Just watched the Back to the Future trilogy in the theater last summer. Oh, dude.
Hell yeah. That's awesome.
I don't think I didn't see it in the theater, actually. I saw it as a kid on VHS, but, B MAGA 123, Back to the Future is God tier cinema, GOAT trilogy. My opinion, all three movies are amazing. 1 and 2 being the best. Yeah, I agree. I ranked them at the beginning of my channel and I ranked them in order, essentially.
Same. I would do the same thing. Yeah.
That's how I like them. Dynamite Mike Tiger. It's time to party like 1985. Absolutely. Got my Blu-ray on pause. Okay, we'll get going. Fachi, what's going on, buddy?
What up, dude?
What a banger. Movie Misfits, how you doing, buddy? He says, hey everyone.
What's up, Chris?
Yeah, Tim says good movies are timeless. Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Make like a tree and press play. Alrighty then.
Mike is in, he's ready. He's ready to go.
Technicat says, hi, how are you doing, Technicat?
What up?
And Tim says, I have my Demon Lover on DVD. I've been meaning to show my wife that movie. I've been talking about it to her. And I said, I got to get that. I got to order that on Blu-ray, man, because that was one of the ones I watched as a kid. All right, let's get this thing going, guys. I'll count down from 5. And then when you hear me press play, let's all press play together. Five, four, three, two, one, play. Alrighty. Chris says, what are you looking at, butthead? Oh, excellent. Spielberg, of course.
What a great opening, like the ticking of the clock.
Right.
Brings back so many memories, man.
I find every, it's one of the few movies, there's some movies in the 80s that find do this for me. Every scene is iconic. Mm. You almost go through every scene in this movie.
Like, just watching this part right here brings me back to, like, my childhood, just because I watched this movie so many times as a kid. It was just, like, seeing all these clocks and whatnot. And I remember always getting kind of grossed out by the dog food.
The dog food?
Yeah.
And I like how you don't see Marty right away. You just see this character walk in, and it's just like, Crispin Glover. By the way, he was on an episode of Family Ties as one of Michael J. Fox's friends.
That's funny.
So that's that was kind of, I remember seeing it, and I go, it's pretty funny. But yeah, where he goes, that's disgusting. Now, I played in a band in high school, so me and my buddy Mike, we would rewind this part over and over where he turns the amp on.
Yeah.
You know, the rock and roll part coming up.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, it's just, he even got me a silver pick one day, like Back to the Future.
Oh, dude, I love that. He said, you guys are just too down loud.
Yep.
No, the silver pick
soundtrack.
Oh,
I loved it. Chris says, every character has a role to play. Every scene matters and is important, all while having the magic and charm. They don't make them like this anymore. No, they don't. I say this about this movie, and I don't know if everyone agrees, but the first 20 minutes, they have to set so much up for the rest of the movie. Because we have to introduce George McFly and Biff and that relationship and the mother, you know, showing that she's a little bit of a drunk, right? All the stuff that takes place. And they have to do it really quickly, but yet it doesn't harm the pacing at all.
No, 100%.
That's what.
Oh, here comes that gross dog food.
Calcon.
That's funny. No, I have this weird thing where I try to collect things from, like, Back to the Future. So, for instance, like, if I was to ever find a can of that, I would probably want it to put in my display case.
That's
like all these old, like, little things I always have, like, in my little Back to the Future collection. I have, like, a little glass case for it, and I have all this, like, weird product placement stuff in there. I got that skateboard.
Oh, God.
And all this stuff, too, like, you know, now you get it. But as a kid, like, all this hidden stuff where they show the plutonium on the news and then you see this box. And, like, you know, as a kid, I wasn't really sure, like, how it connected right away. And then once you start getting the movie going, you're like, oh, yeah.
I can remember being 6 years old because I was born in 1979 and looking in the paper and seeing the ad, Back to the Future playing now. And you know, so the poster always takes me back. I can just never forget it.
Mm-hmm.
Chris says, what's even more amazing that this wasn't planned as a trilogy. So this, see the way everything ties together so flawlessly is incredible. 100%. Oh yeah.
I always was curious. What's the deal with this guitar? Why was it so little?
I don't know. 80s thing, I guess.
It's like a little guitar.
Magus says, I want Marty's Toyota pickup, right?
Oh, dude, that's like my dream car, for real.
Destroys Doc's freaking lab.
They re-released the Toyota pickup a couple years ago in, like, a limited edition. They, like, it was upgraded, like, from a Tacoma, and they made it out to look like the pickup. It was pretty sick.
Rock and roll.
And roll.
Now, there's a few scenes I want to mention while we're at them about why he was replaced or why Eric Stoltz was replaced. Because Michael J. Fox's physical comedy can't be understated, and his chemistry with Christopher Lloyd.
Oh yeah,
it makes it work so much.
You know, the one of my, like, dreams is to get as finished as possible edition of that Stoltz cut. I mean, we get clips here and there, but I would love to see it all put together and see exactly what they filmed, because for such an iconic movie, I would just love to see, like, what could have been, even though this is going to be better, but it's just something about it that I just feel like I just really want to see, you know, that thing put together and how it and see, like, why they thought it just wasn't working. because Stoltz is a good actor.
He is a good actor. I just don't think he had the time. I think it was a timing thing. He just wasn't jiving with Christopher Lloyd. There's a few scenes in here. Like my favorite scene in the whole movie is when they do the experiment the first time. And he's like 88 miles per hour. And the way Michael J. Fox is just going, you disintegrated Einstein.
Yeah.
Like just when we get there, just watch the comedic timing he has. I think a lot of that is what it was. Like that tit for tat wasn't there. That
sure.
And he like in Teen Wolf too, he has a physical con, like when he's sliding down the hallways. Like you can't teach that. That's
like with the water and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. I wanted to be Marty McFly when I was a kid. I had a skateboard. 100%. I still wear a vest in the winter. Oh, yeah, like man. In the winter, I wear a vest all winter. I don't wear a coat. Like it's I just funny wanted because, to be that.
I work at a gym and I'm a fitness coach. And every time there's this woman, and she always comes in with a vest on. And every time she walks in, I always say, would you jump ship? And she's like, stop saying that.
That's what everyone says to me at work. This dork thinks he's going to drown. That's what I mean. It's iconic, these lines. B-Manga has, have you seen the deleted footage with Eric Stoltz? I like Eric, but they made the right choices switching a Fox. Yeah. Michael J. Fox was supposed to be Jesse in Nightmare on Elm Street Part 2, but he just didn't have the time. I heard that. Wow. That was one of their choices, but he was so, like, that was 1985 as well. Can you imagine? But I could see Michael J. Fox doing that role.
Like, oh, that's funny. Dynamite Tiger. He says, I wish. So there's a dude who watches the show called, and his name's Mayor. So every time he comes in the chat, I always go, Mayor. So he goes, yeah, I wish he was in here.
Yeah, Foxy, great double feature, the Sand Team Wolf.
Yeah. Here we go. Yui.
Yeah. Yeah. He is so damn likable for sure.
With the pinheads.
I love this, how he's playing like Van Halen and everything. It's great. But what are we setting up here? We're setting up how much Marty is like his dad. How much he doesn't really, he's not as a confident kid as we're, he's led to believe.
Hold it.
Oh, Daner, I know you love this movie, buddy. Hello, hello. Anybody home?
Yeah, I love that movie, Secret of My Success.
I don't remember it, man. I want to rewatch that one.
Oh, you got it's so it's probably my third favorite Fox movie.
I thought about doing a series. This hit me because I was thinking about this while we're doing this. Remember when they ruled the 80s kind of thing? So talking about people who were so big in the 80s that it was like the Sylvester Stallones, Michael J. Fox, Arnold.
Oh, yeah.
You know, all these actors who were, you have no idea how big they were. Like, kind of speaking to this generation, showing them like, you have no idea.
Was there any actors as a kid that you watched that like, you thought for sure they were going to be actors you were going to see in a lot of movies? Like, for some reason, I always assumed I was going to see, what's his name? Zach Galligan in so much stuff after Gremlins. I'm like, oh, he's going to be in everything. And like, he never really did much, you know, like he was in such a hit movie as like the main lead. You never really saw him in much after that.
I can't think of anybody off the top of my head, but,
Spader would be a good
That's a good question. You know who else was in Family Ties? The fourth episode in? Alex Keaton loses his virginity to Amy Steele.
No way.
This old girl going to college. It would have been around Friday the 13th, part two, right?
That's wild.
Yeah, it's definitely
what you need to do is you need to splice something together to make like a reel where like they're in bed together, and then that's why Jason's chasing her because like she had sex. That's the reel right there.
Light of the clock tower. I love this. Again, we're setting stuff up here. Here are all the pieces they're laying out. That's why I love the writing in this movie. It's
There you go, lady. It's a quarter.
Maybe Carrie Fisher.
Mm-hmm.
Surprised she Claudia didn't do Wells, a lot more.
I met her, and I didn't get it, but she has those clock tower things, and on the back, she'll sign it like the same way she signed it for him, but she'll sign it to you. It's pretty sick.
I did a convention before COVID. I went to one, mm-hmm. so I got to sit in the DeLorean.
Oh, nice.
It was amazing. But I bought the paper with George McFly's death. Come back to Future 2. I actually have the newspaper of
that. That's
of
awesome.
That. It's pretty awesome. B. Magus says, I thought we'd see a lot more Henry Thomas, but he kind of disappeared for a while.
He's another one. Yeah.
When I loved as a kid with Henry. Well, Mike Flanagan ignited that guy's career again.
Oh, totally. Big time. Totally. He's like everywhere now.
Who do you like more, Claudia Wells or Elizabeth Shue?
All right.
I think Elizabeth Shue's the better actress.
I 100% agree. Elizabeth Shue's like one of my favorite actresses of all time. Like, she really is. And I think she's so much better than Claudia Wells. But I think Claudia Wells was a better Jennifer, I thought. But maybe it was just because I was so used to the original. I don't know. But I don't know if, like, Claudia Wells would have been able to do the same thing that she did in the second one, where she saw herself and all this other stuff. Like,
now, this actor, Thomas Wilson, was mm-hmm. born in 1955, April 15th. His birthday was yesterday.
Really?
Yeah.
I saw him live a couple of years ago in a comedy show. He did, like, stand-up.
That's funny. He plays the stereotypical bully so well, though.
Yeah.
I spilt beer all over it. I wonder why the car... What a character.
Hello.
There we go. There it is. Think. I even do that to my kids. Like, as a joke. I go, think, yeah. McFly. Think. They don't really get it, though, because...
Of course not. Biff.
All kids do is watch YouTube now. It's
yeah.
Pretty crazy. Daner says, who would have thought the kid from E.T. could be Jack Torrance?
That's true.
It's true, man.
All you got for me is light beer?
Like, every line's great.
Say hi to your mom for me.
Look at the makeup, though. It holds up well. Making them look old.
It holds up so much, man. It's almost like uncanny. Like, you don't even remember that he's got prosthetics on. All of them. They look great. For 1985, too.
Confrontations.
Don't you think, like, look at him right there, and they aged him. How much better does that look than when they do that, like, AI aging and CGI aging?
Oh, I know. I don't know. This is what I don't get. It's like, I get it takes more time. It takes more time. You got to create this stuff. You only have one shot at if something falls off or whatever. I get it. But look at that. Look how good they look.
Peanut brittle, dude. I haven't had that shit in like forever. Remember that stuff? Yeah, man. I totally agree. Like, I don't know why the CGI de-aging looks terrible, I think, compared to like what they did here.
My wife hates that. I love doing that to her. I go, oh. It's probably the funniest laugh of all time.
It's so good. Did you see she just posted a picture. I think it was her kid's birthday, and she gave him that cake. They had she had them do that cake up.
That's funny. Again, look at the family setting. They're not a close family at all. Not really. Like, Marty's just like looking at them all and just saying nothing. And
change that oil.
Crispin is so good, man.
So good.
I want to do a science fiction series and call it science fiction theater and do I'll miss my favorite television program. Science fiction theater.
Call the boy. Like, that was so stupid.
George McFly looks ready to pull out a gun in a fast food restaurant because they stopped serving breakfast.
Yeah, it's like falling down or whatever.
B Mega, you nailed that laugh, dude. Thank you. I practice a lot because I loved it so much. That and John Candy's laugh is the funniest thing ever.
Even her makeup job, look, this is HD. Like, this looks great still.
Yeah, it's fantastic.
It was a big storm that night. Remember, George?
They did the bags under the eyes really, really well.
Yeah, and they just set it up there, too, talking about the storm at the dance. Yeah, they kind of, you know, play that in right now.
Summer Rental with Candy is another underrated 80s classic. So yeah, good. So good.
He was all red. He's like, I'm just getting a bass.
I like the way
that, man, like, looking at that, like, Diet Pepsi free can, like, just is awesome. Like, I just love all the product placement of this movie.
Dynamite Tiger says Lorraine make it look she was a saint in high school. Well, that was the concept of this story. It was that when your parents would say, I walked uphill to go to school in the snow and all this. Like, were they really telling the truth? That's what the concept of the story was.
Or like when your parents were like, oh, you should have seen me. I was like an all-star basketball player or something, but you don't really know. You know, you don't know. No. Man, I miss malls, dude. We don't have them much anymore here.
We got one where I live, but it's more of like at Christmas time is the only time it's really busy.
So epic. Like, I just don't understand why they don't make movies like this anymore with, like, such a great story, something unique. Like, all this, it's like, everything now is just, like, action 24/7. There's no build. There's nothing original. Yeah. And I don't know why. Like, you look at this, and it was just so, it was a little bit off the walls. Like, hey, we're going to make a time machine. They're going to go back in time. He's going to hang out with his parents when they're kids. Like,
it sparked our imagination. It sparked our imagination. That's there's the DeLorean.
Like, what would you even call this? Like, an adventure movie? Like, what would you even like?
It's a genre splicer. Like the way I talk about Predator, how it hits so many genres. Same with Terminator, it hits so many genres. This is sci-fi, adventure, comedy, several. You know what I mean?
I feel like they're so afraid to make movies like this anymore with, like, just like an adventure story, you know. I don't know why.
Is that a Devo suit? Christopher Lloyd really makes his presence known in this movie. Like,
oh man, it's unbelievable. Like, how old was he? 40 something in this?
47, I think. I think someone said earlier in the chat. Yeah, product of the time. 80s was the golden decade. Yeah, and every director had their own stamp. You know what I mean?
Right. And I feel like they were a lot more risky back then, where it's like they let these directors and these writers come up with these stories that seem bonkers, but once you put it to film, it makes so much sense. Nowadays, a lot of these movies would be squashed as soon as they came to the table because they'd think they were ridiculous, right? So,
right.
Instead, they're just going to be like, let's just do Thor 6 again. Oh, yeah.
So many good movies from the 80s. Oh, absolutely. Just them standing there is so iconic.
Oh, yeah. When they turn around and the flames are going, I mean, that scene is still iconic today, 40 years later.
It's the way he's looking at him.
Ballsy.
Hey, film kid, what's going on?
What up?
Great effects still.
Oh.
Miles per hour.
Now, this, I want you guys to look at this. Watch Michael J. Fox's reaction here. It's timing.
Yep. He's about talking about Einstein, right?
Yeah, he thought he blew up Einstein, and it just, geez.
Yeah, yeah, look at his like expressions and stuff. How great this is! When the hell are they?
He's like freaking out.
But imagine seeing that and being like, "What the heck just happened?"
The physicality he has, he could be just directed really well too.
Zemeckis, right? On a DeLorean?
Look out.
I love this. What is it, hot? No, it's cold. Damn cold.
The feeling we get from movies of this time period can't be replicated. Yeah.
You wonder if kids nowadays are going to have the same feeling with movies when they're older. I can't see it because I feel like it's just they see it and then they never want to see it again. Like it's like not something they watch on a regular basis. Like I must have watched this because we didn't have access to so much stuff. So, I mean, when I got this VHS, which I have right here, I remember I watched this day in and day out because it's all you had. You couldn't be like, oh, well, on to the next one. Like I got a couple VHS tapes a year. So you had to really just.
Yeah, I agree.
Keep watching the ones you had.
Oh, Tim says, look out. Film Kid says, I'm a kid nowadays and I love this movie. Excellent.
Nice. That's what I like to hear though, is that people of other new generations are still loving some of this stuff and can appreciate it.
Yeah, well, you hit on that's you're absolutely right. I think about the movies now, like are they going to be talking about Avengers Endgame 30 years from now and go, oh, that may be the exception, but I'm just saying the whole Marvel craze.
Right, could have been.
Are they going to be looking at it like, oh, you should have been there? You know,
don't think anymore. I think if they would have stopped at some point, but there's so many now. What do you think they're going to say? Like, oh, do you remember Ant-Man 2? Like, I just feel like there's so many now that it's like hard to eat. I think for even the hardcore fans to keep up.
It's paint by numbers now. It's just.
And I think it's so easy to make because basically everything now is CGI except the actors, right? Like the whole backgrounds are now just basically CGI backgrounds. It's not like they're going on sites a lot of the times anymore.
Yeah, I'm not sure. Don't get me wrong, though. Like, I think in the last 20 years, we've got amazing movies. We've had really thought-provoking, really good movies. I asked the question once about what movie in the last 10 years, let's say, would you say is going to be a classic 30 years from now? Where we'll be looking back going, do you remember that movie? And I think A Quiet Place, maybe. It may have some legs to stand on 20 years from now.
I see, like, it's tough because I don't watch a lot of modern movies that aren't outside of the horror genre, so it's hard for me to really, like, I actually thought that Ready Player One was a good movie.
Yeah, I like that one.
I thought that was really well done. It was different. Like, I haven't seen Oppenheimer yet. I haven't seen the new Dunes yet. Like, so I don't know, like, if those are going to be something that people are going to remember. I mean, I thought Hereditary was really good. I don't know if that's something that's going to stay popular, like, in the horror genre in years to come.
Yeah. The suckers!
21 Jigger? What did I just say?
See the way they're working together, though, the way they're bouncing off each other. I think this is what they wanted and it wasn't getting.
I gave him a box full of old pinball machine balls.
My favorite thing. I love it.
I'm not going to piss anybody off. There was a long period of time I was trying to find that trunk, a yellow trunk like that to replicate that thing.
That's funny, man. Film Kid says, I saw The Thing and oh my god, it was amazing. Yeah, it really is, dude. I'm glad you're watching some of those old classics. B Magnus says, I'm burnt out on superhero movies. I don't ever get burned out on 80s masterpieces. Yeah, they were just doing a lot of things. Every director had their own stamp. Bob Zemeckis, Spielberg, James Cameron. You know, and the actors, I mean, Stallone was doing his thing. Arnold was doing his thing. You had like movies like Lethal Weapon, Die Hard, The Karate Kid. Everything was different.
It was unique at the time, you know, like Karate Kid. I don't think, like, unless if the Karate Kid wasn't such a hit, they're going to do like remakes and stuff. I think if someone came to the table in 2024 with an original idea that this old man teaches a kid karate and then he joins a tournament, I think they would probably laugh in the guy's face that came up with that idea in 2024, if it never existed. But in 1984, they were like, let's do it. Let's go. Yeah.
Film Kid thinks Top Gun Maverick may be a classic from years.
It's a good movie, man.
Yeah, it's a good one. Cocaine Bear.
I still haven't watched it. I still haven't watched it.
Oh, I didn't do nothing for me.
Somebody recommended it and I bought it and then I still haven't put it in yet.
Arnold is my favorite action star. I love about every movie he's in. It's because he has charisma.
I agree.
You don't find that charisma anymore.
No. Charm, charisma. Dynamike, was it you that told me to buy the Cocaine Bear? Because I have it. I just haven't watched it. Don't let me in. Go.
Uncle Jay Fox.
Even this whole like scene too, with like them like shooting guns at each other, machine guns. I guess you won't see this now.
Movie Misfit says, "For me, and speaking of Spielberg, I gotta go Ready Player One. Checked all those boxes for a good classic adventure and is filled with nostalgia, which I'm not complaining about." Yeah.
Yeah, I agree. I actually thought that was a really good movie.
Film Kid says, I just wanted to tell you guys, if these guys have any Regal theaters near you, they're doing a re-release for Alien this month. Oh, sweet.
I do have a Regal, actually.
I'm in Canada. We have Cineplex. That's our Canadian theater chain, but we also
we don't have a Cineplex here. Did you get that Slimer with the blue thing?
No.
Oh, that was, everybody was after it, but it was like a Canadian exclusive, I guess.
Oh, I didn't know that. We just went to the wife and I went and saw Godzilla X Kong.
Oh yeah.
And that was the first movie outing I've been to in the theater in about 3 years.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, all those popcorn tickets are the new thing now.
Yeah, I'm trying to go more often now, but
it's hard, man. I don't go a lot either.
Yeah, I'm definitely going to see Kingdom of the Apes, though.
This is the new Planet of the Apes one, right?
Yeah.
Dude, you know what's so wild? I was just looking at this. This movie was rated PG, and that guy literally just shot Doc with a machine gun.
Yeah.
And killed him.
Like, different time, man.
Like, what the fuck? Like, this was like little kids are going to see this movie and just accepting that, like, this guy's going to blow a bazooka through Marty. And he just said bastards and all this shit.
Now we're going to the studio back lot.
There we go. Boom.
Gremlins was filmed, the studio back lot, Back to the Future as Hill Valley. Dynamite Tiger says, what props or replicas do you all have from the Back to the Future franchise? I just have the George McFly newspaper. I don't have a lot of Back to the Future stuff. I would love to get the flux capacitor.
I have the flux. I have the skateboard, the hoverboard. I got the Nike mags. I got the part two hat. I got the I have the newspaper with the one with Michael J. Fox in the front where he was arrested. I've got a can of Pepsi Free. I have
nice
the little Pizza Hut pizza thing that they put in the microwave in part two.
That's funny.
I got a lot of stuff. I actually should probably do a video on some of that stuff. Is that the dad from Silent Night, Deadly Night, the grandfather?
Yes, that is actually. Yeah. He's a creepy part of that film.
Yeah, he is.
What he's doing right now, you can't teach. It's just
when he trips over the thing, when he's running back in and stuff. Yeah.
Yeah. It's, I think it was that, those kind of nuances, those kind of subtleties that they weren't getting maybe. Cause I know Eric Stoltz filmed 70% of the movie.
Yeah. That's why I would love to see it. This guy's trying to shoot Marty with a shotgun in like a rated PG movie.
You mutated son of a bitch. Dynamite Tiger says, I love it. Yeah, man, a video on movie prop replicas sounds fun.
Yeah, I will. I'll get it together. I have the book that George wrote at the end.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah. There it is, Lion Estates.
His neighborhood.
Yeah.
His neighborhood's not even built yet.
It's wild. Like, I saw somebody ask about if we had a time machine, where would we go? I don't know. Part of me feels like I would go back. I know it's only one day, but I would love to go back to see myself as, like, a little kid.
I'd go back to 1985, then.
Yeah, I mean, for real. I mean, I could go the same. You know, there's a lot of family members that would still be alive and all this other stuff. It would be, you know, interesting to be able to go back.
I mean, I can remember, it may seem kind of strange to a lot younger, this generation, but to be able to go to the movies with your family was like a huge event. Like,
oh yeah.
I remember when Batman from 1989 came out. We all got together. Oh. We all went to the movies. Same. And it was just
it was
huge.
A madness. It was like lines out the door. Everybody was all excited with their Batman gear on.
Now it seems like going to the theater is just not a big thing anymore. It's,
nope.
It's not the thing to do anymore. Like, because nope. That's all we had, though. That's.
Did you ever do, where I was growing up, they used to do, this is probably when I was like teenager in my 20s. They used to always do like a Thursday at midnight showing if like the hardcore people wanted to catch a movie first. So when you'd go to like midnight on a Thursday, you'd always see the hardcore of the hardcore, like either it's horror or whatnot, because they would want to get that early screening. Where now, I think they do like Thursday movie showings at like 7 p.m. and then it really opens on Friday kind of thing. So it's, I don't know if you guys ever did something like that where you were, but I used to do that a lot.
I don't necessarily remember that, but sometimes like my brother would take me to the show. My first theater experience I remember, Popeye was my first movie.
That's funny.
With Robin Williams. But Return of the Jedi was the first one I remember. My dad took us all to see Return of the Jedi.
That's
1983. And I was like 4 years old. So that was like, I was really young.
Yeah, I don't know what my first movie would have been. Maybe, I don't even know the date. Remember the movie American Tail with Fievel?
Yeah.
I definitely saw that in the theater as a little kid. I don't know what year that came out, so I'd have a tough time thinking of what how old I would have been.
Wasn't Goonies also PG with a dead guy in the freezer? Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Good point, actually. Film Kids says, tomorrow on my channel, I'm releasing a Great Escape review. Oh, nice.
Old school.
Oh, very old school. Yeah, Chuck E. Cheese, then the movies, right?
Hell yeah. 1955.
November 5th, 1955. So my dad would have been 9 months old.
Crazy.
And that
time, time is nuts, man. You jump shit. He just jumped off the boat, came to the place.
5 cents for coffee. I remember my mom telling me like she'd go to the movies for like a quarter.
Yeah. 16, 164 Riverside Drive.
Good, you're alive. Film Kid says, what's your most anticipated movie of the year that hasn't come out already? For me, I would say Alien Romulus. Yeah, I'm excited about that after seeing the teaser. I'd say Kingdom of the Apes. I'm a huge Planet of the Apes fan.
So, I'm really excited for Maxine now that I saw that trailer. And I'm actually hearing that Beetlejuice 2, surprisingly, is supposed to be really good. And I was kind of on the fence about them pulling that off the right way. But I guess there's been a couple, there's been a screener and people have said it's really good. So I'm interested
to hear because I've been going through some 2023 movies from big franchises. I didn't like Dial of Destiny that much. Expendables 4 was terrible.
Yeah. They can't pull it off, man. It's tough. I don't know
why. The Exorcist Believer wasn't very good. Like all these the Flash was sucked. I was like, oh, but didn't like it. I appreciate seeing Michael Keaton again, but so I'm like, I'm not. They just keep taking these franchises, these legacy characters, and they just, I don't know. It's like they don't know how to handle them.
No, I think it's just a lot of it's just cash grab, I think, at this point.
Yeah.
Like the whole thing with Blumhouse doing Blair Witch, like, why? Like, you'll never you'll never capture what that movie was and what made that movie special.
I don't get that either. Well, this is the way they really look back in 1985.
Yeah. Smacked them hard there.
You notice Billy Zane is one of the thugs? Or one of the punks?
Why do you let those boys do that to you? Talk to you like that. They're bigger than me.
This is great, man, the way he's looking at George.
Yeah, imagine seeing your father your age. Like,
yeah, that'd be bizarre.
It's gonna be mayor.
Man, I remember playing the Back to the Future game for the original Nintendo.
Yeah.
And then throwing the pies in the diner. I couldn't get past it. I was like
mayor.
I hate manure.
Good.
Mayor Goldie Wilson.
Dad, I mean George. I just heard about this today.
Massive Ninja Turtles fan and have high hopes for the new rated R last month that was announced. I'm hoping to hire Jim Henson Creature Shop for the effects. Well, we'll see.
I'm excited. I mean, Turtles 90 is one of my favorite movies of all time, so I'm hoping we get something cool, but I don't know. It's hard for me to really believe, you know?
Yeah.
I'll wait and see, but hard.
Oh, that's what the old man was doing. He's a peeping Tom, peeping man. Hey, Ginger, what's up, buddy?
What's up, man?
How's everyone going? I hope all is well. All is well.
All is good, man.
You know, it was a hectic day. Oof. Haven't stopped all day.
I hear ya.
Playing soccer with my kids, and they wore me right out.
Look at that, huh?
Now he's changing the space-time continuum now.
Man, he whacked his head pretty damn hard on that pavement, though. Calvin, why do you call me Calvin?
It's written all over your underwear.
I think I need some purple Calvins now, to be honest with you. I think that's the key.
There's that nice Dean Cundey lighting, everyone. Can't believe it's his mom.
I mean, think about how crazy that would be.
Well, I remember seeing pictures of, you know, when my parents would show me pictures of my mom and her when she was 20, or my aunt when she's 20, and you're like, that's you? That's you? I'm back, film kid says.
You.
We all wore tidy whities in the 80s.
Hell yeah.
I remember when I was 6 years old, so this would have been 1985, and I snuck into a high school. Because there was the Catholic school, the high school, and the public school all in a row. In the city, like the place I live now. And I just remember the of every big hair, guys wearing leather jackets, like
sick.
Heavy metal heads everywhere. Like it's just,
I love it. Everybody looked so old and now they all look so young. It's like crazy.
Yeah. Look at the timing he has. Like, so watch when he puts his pants on here. Like, this is the kind of stuff I love about Michael J. Fox. Yeah.
He like puts his leg in, he's like hopping around or whatever.
He's hot and he falls on his freaking head. You're a sailor. Film Kid says, born to be rad. This is a compliment, but you look like someone straight out of the Lost Boys.
That's the biggest compliment you could have given me, man. It's like one of my favorite movies, dude. Thank you so much. What?
Get used to these bars, kid. I mean, these are all his uncles. He's sitting around with all his uncles as kids and stuff, right?
Yeah.
It's crazy.
Dinner. Nobody has two television sets. Jason Hervey.
You see 2024?
Yeah, I know. Every room.
Every room.
You must be right. The classic.
It's brand new.
I know. They must think he's like the biggest bullshitter. He's like, I have two TVs. I've seen this episode. They must be like, who's this guy?
Is that the mother from Gremlins?
Let me see. Nobody's home. I don't think so.
No, it's a little different, eh?
Half past Maple.
Who the hell is John F. Kennedy?
They don't even know this kid. They're just like, yeah, sleep over with my daughter. That's fine.
Now, there is a cut scene you probably know of, and I get why they cut it, too. It's where he goes, Doc, I don't know if I can go through this. What if I end up being gay in the future?
Oh, dude, and he goes, you,
and Christopher Lloyd's going, you should be happy.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean,
it was funny, but I could see why they went, oh, I think we got to cut that.
Yep. It's probably better off they would have tried to cancel the movie.
My thoughts on Heat. Heat is a fantastic crime thriller. Love it.
I like Heat too, yeah.
Love Heat. It's probably some of the best acting you'll ever see.
Did you see that house that Doc lives in? It's like a freaking mansion, dude. What the? It was so big.
I think he inherited a lot of money, and that's how he got to do all these, you know, science experiments and how he made the time machine.
Little Einstein. Well, it's crazy because it doesn't even make sense that would be Einstein, right? That means they would be like 30.
No, I think it's a completely different dog. Like, I think he calls him something else.
Oh, does he?
Yeah.
The ghost guy. Do you know what this means?
This damn thing doesn't work. You got to get one of those, Garrett.
I don't have one of those. It doesn't work at all.
Ronald Reagan, the actor. Love it.
Who's the vice president? Jerry Lewis?
I always call this the quintessential 80s movie where it's timeless, but yet it's so 80s.
Yeah. It's wild because if you think if they ever tried to redo this now and you think of 2024 and then they had to go back, they'd go back to what, 30 years ago? That'd be like the 90s. Like how kids wouldn't even know how to like get around. No phones, nothing. Like it would be a disaster.
Film Kids is Jason. As I said, congrats on 2.9 million views on the short and for slasher movie review series. I know this isn't really a slasher, but can you do Killer from Outer Space? I'll think about it. Yeah, I had a short that just exploded, and that's where all my subs. 2.9
million?
It was just an Indian. So here, this is what I did. I did 31 movies that made me. So movies that I grew up with that made me the movie fan I am. So I did Temple of Doom. Just took a clip from Temple of Doom and said, you know, whatever. And it went up to like 2.9 million views, got all these subs from it.
Holy shit.
Yeah, that's why I tell people I just got lucky. All my subs are pretty much, I mean, I appreciate it. Like,
that's wild, man.
But at the same time, you go, what? You know what? I bust my ass right on my channel. Maybe it's just karma. I don't know.
You know what? Do you want to hear something crazy? Being a huge 80s fan that I am, I've never seen any Indiana Jones movies.
Oh, that
never.
Is
it's like, it's almost like a running joke on my channel. And I just bought them all in 4K, being like, all right, this is the year I'm going to do it. And then I'll do like a first time watch video or something like that.
You know, that's really, that's, there's some, I haven't seen Fast Times at Ridgemont High yet.
Oh, really? That's my favorite comedy, actually.
Yeah, I haven't seen a few, actually, that I've been trying to get onto. As much as I have seen.
I don't know why Indiana Jones passed me by. My brother, the same thing. He still has never seen it. So we want to do a watch along for the first time. But like, I don't know how that didn't, like, I knew of it, but if for some reason I never saw it. I saw Star Wars. I saw E.T., Gremlins.
Temple of Doom was the one I watched all the time. It's my favorite.
Yeah, it's very hard to be a YouTube creator, that's for sure. It takes a lot of time, patience. It's like a part-time job, man, for real. Like, once you start getting rolling,
you don't get paid.
Yeah, like if you get rolling and then you want to like grow the channel and be entertaining and whatnot, like it does become a part-time job.
Yeah, I agree with Film Kid. It's tough, man. I'm telling you, I've learned a lot in the last 3 years. I've rebranded a new channel. Obviously, I'm comfortable in front of a camera now. I'm still working on, I want my reviews to be better as far as performance goes. My editing, I got down. That's just because I've learned. You got to work on it, man. You got to work on it. Like, I've tried everything too. Like when I do reviews, I've tried just going off the cuff like this and doing it. And sometimes it works. Other times I've done notes. Other times I've laid out every line. Like I've tried it so many different ways. It just depends on the movie I'm talking about, how comfortable I am. Like I could talk Rocky off the cuff because I just know it. But I say, you just got to work on it. It's a skill. It's a skill, man.
Consistency is important too. Like,
yeah,
you got to try to, you know, I would say at least average a video a week, you know, to stay like in the groove, you know?
And what works for me is I batch record. Like, I had a day off last week and I did 5 videos at once.
I need to do more of that, to be honest with you, because my channel, I have like, I do a lot of lives and that's where I get all my videos in. Like it'll have different, you know, it'll have different plots or context or whatever, but they'll always be live. For me, it's like, it's so hard for me to do a video because it's like, I feel like the only time that I'm free is like late at night. So I'm like, I'll just go live and talk to people and I'll just do like whatever the video was going to be instead of just putting it out and editing it. I need to do more of that. I need to get better at that. And like you said, bulk is probably awesome. Like I need to just try to find a day where I can bulk like 3 or 4 and then just edit them and release them like every few days.
Well, now I'm not so tired. I can just pick away at the editing. That's just the way I like to. And I work well on my own. So like I did, I've been going through the Planet of the Apes movies. So I recorded 3 of those reviews. I did a tier ranking and I did the Terminator Sarah Connor Chronicles. Reviewed that.
The show?
The show.
I like that show. I have those on. There was 2 seasons, right?
Yeah.
I thought that was a pretty good show.
So now I'm thinking, okay, now I'm editing. Got 2 more to edit. So now I go, okay, what am I ready to record next? So I'm like, okay, I'm going to do this next Apes review. I'm going to do this, could do this. So I like to do at least 3 whenever I come down here. Plus, I got the watch parties like this, or I'll fit a live show in or whatever. Film Race. Kid says, in March, I hit my 1 year anniversary on the channel. Awesome. That's I go, good. Yeah, but Film Kid, you're only 11 years old, man. I wish I was doing this.
Is he really? Wow.
Yeah. Yeah.
Wow. That's impressive. I wish I started at 11.
He goes, I just hit 240 subs. And for my first episode of my podcast, I got Sean freaking Chandler for it. Yeah. Wow. Sean is very reachable and he'll come on your channel. He's really cool now. Oh no, you're 12 now, dude. Awesome. This is heavy.
Is that word again? Heavy.
That's him. I like the how they become best friends, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Didn't that guy ever have hair? Do you imagine trying to make your own existence happen? You got to get your parents together. Like, that'd be
so funny.
All the girls are looking at him too, looking at Marty.
Joe just walks away. Oh, this is heavy.
Look at Doc. Doc's like, this is messed up. Hey, Tim, what's going on, buddy? One of my great followers.
What up, Tim?
So what's up, guys?
What up? That's that word again, heavy. Is there a problem with the Earth's gravitational pull?
Yeah, it's like going back to the 90s. You did this movie now, it'd be like everyone's saying, bra. What's bra?
Nothing.
Nothing. Oh, it's all right, Tim. I'm late. The DeLorean stalled and had the date and time wrong. Damn.
Lorraine. Science fiction stories. Crispin Glover is something else, huh?
Yeah, he's such a good actor. Film, because I know a lot of people like RoboCop, but I love it. I think it's a perfect film.
So good, man.
Because you're very impressionable, Film Kid, at your age. Because I was. I was very impressionable at that age and when watching that stuff. So movies hit a little different when you're a young lad.
I mean, some of the stuff in RoboCop was out of control. So much, so violent for that time. And they had like kids' toys, you know, like a lot of kids were going to see it because they had all the action figures and stuff.
The thing here with Marty is that that's his mom. That's the thing here.
Yeah.
That's not his father's girlfriend or father's. That's his mom. So he sees somebody handling his mom, right? Up.
Get your meat hooks off.
Oh, Biff, I realized how big you are.
The way they angled the camera too was great. You know, like angled it down or whatever and angled it up. With the old Biff, it's make like a tree and leave, you idiot. And he's like hitting it with the cane.
Yep. I think you'd be surprised if you could even go five, even if you go 10 years back to your younger self and going, man, you were freaking stupid. What's wrong with you?
Yeah. I mean, I think it'd be, it's one of those things you'd love to go back and like give yourself pointers and tips or whatever. Or anybody in this planet. Darth Vader came from the planet Falcon and told me that he'd fry my brain. Silence, Earthling. He's like playing like Van Halen.
Yeah, he puts about Van Halen.
Sounded like in 1955 to someone who's never heard that kind of music before. Must have.
Oh,
like,
it'd be alien music. You like who played guitar like that in the '50s? Like whammy bar going and freaking.
So clever though to use this. As like... It was such a clever thing to do that, though.
Yeah, it's before Star Wars. It's before Star Trek, so... He's trying to twist off a...
I remember when I was a kid, I was like, Darth Vader didn't wear a yellow suit.
The thing with Crispin Glover is that he believes it.
Oh yeah.
Like he's selling like what he's what this that it was real.
Yeah, Tim, we just said that how crazy that would be if someone went back in time today, it'd be 1994. Yeah. And how different that really would be for kids.
Don't kiss. Well, I gotta go. I got school tomorrow. Oh,
all right, thanks, rest, dude. I friend. Appreciate you checking it out.
Check out Garrett's channel. It's in the description below. Everyone, too.
Thanks, man.
Tim, yeah, 1994. That's the when I started high school. Was basically 1994. Yeah, we had no cell phones. There was no cell phones. There was no
computers.
Dial well, up internet.
Computers were like, yeah, AOL chats and stuff.
Yeah, it was that. It was freaking. So yeah, you could play with some stuff if you did a remake. But,
yeah, it would actually be kind of funny to see how they kind of take a kid and bring them back to the 94. And I mean, even think about that. Like that was like when dial up internet. Remember when you would like be on the computer and then someone would pick up the phone, it would shut the whole thing down.
Yeah.
Like you couldn't have like two things going at once.
Well, I guess that horror flick, Totally Killer, was kind of a...
Yeah.
It did a little bit of a Back to the Future thing. Hey, Ronnie, all the good names are taking podcasts. It was a better time. Oh, yeah.
What up, man?
I was a young kid in the 80s, but I was a teenager in the 90s. So.
It's kind of like me, too.
Chris says those AOL messages were wild, but a kid today reacting to dial up an Internet Explorer taking 3 days to load a page would be fun. Yeah, there could be something there, you know, with the, if you could get the same chemistry.
Yeah.
I know the guys behind Cobra Kai, who created Cobra Kai, want to do a Back to the Future of that style.
I mean, if anybody could do it, maybe it could be them. Maybe, right? Yeah. They did a great job with that show, man. That show is better than it ever had the right to be.
Yeah, it didn't. And, you know, I was one of the first ones talking about, not on my channel, but first ones saying when it was on YouTube, I was watching it.
Same.
I was watching Cobra Kai, and people are like, really? Danielson's back? And I go, it's actually really good. I was like telling people, like,
something crazy is where I live, they had, let's say, I think it aired on YouTube on like a Sunday. I don't remember, but probably 3 or 4 days before, at my local movie theater, they played Karate Kid on the big screen. And then afterwards, they played the first two episodes of Cobra Kai before it hit. And I went to that event and I was like mind blown on how good Cobra Kai was.
Yeah. I got to catch up on it now. Kind of behind, but.
Oh, really? Well, you get some time before the next one comes. I think the next one's the last season. It's still good. But this is funny. People are talking about Oregon Trail, Carmen Sandiego. Hell yeah, man. Yep. I played in the computer lab too. That was right. That's where I played those two games for the first time.
No, it's maybe. unpopular opinion, but I'm a bigger fan of Karate Kid Part 2 than I am of the original.
I see a lot of people could say that.
I love it.
Like the original, I actually think Part 3 is freaking super underrated.
I like that one too.
Part 3 has so many good characters like Barnes and Silver.
I like Chosen. That's why
he's like one of the scariest dudes ever.
It was a real fight. That's what I liked about it. It was a real fight. It was like when he said, this is not a tournament, Daniel. This is for real.
Yeah.
I think the emotional performance by Miyagi, Pat Morita, when his father dies and everything, I just think there was so much, I don't know, more emotional weight to that movie.
I agree. And you're right, movie business. Terry Silva's another great villain for sure.
Blasphemy, Jason. I love it. I love the music at the end when he's kicking Chosen's ass. It gives me chills, actually. I love it.
I will say Chosen did have the best pecs in Okinawa, I think, when he ripped his shirt off. I was like, dude, he's jacked, dude.
3 is awesome. Yes, I like 3. Yeah,
3 is great.
Yeah, Terry Silver. Uh-oh, Doc. Watching your own death.
Run for it, Marty.
Completely agree, Chris. Setting of the third act in Karate Kid 2 is beautiful. Mm-hmm. Yeah, and those are movies that I definitely want to go through one day. The doc.
paint it. You needed to like paint it.
Like a knight in shining armor from a long time ago. You just heard a song on the soundtrack. It's my drive to work playlist. Yeah.
I love it.
A flux capacitor.
So
my dad's heroes like Albert Einstein. My dad's an engineer, and he loves the part. He loves the 1.21 gigawatts that we've already passed. But he goes when he's talking to Thomas Edison, it can't be done. It can't be done. Tim says, 2 is really good. I still think First Karate Kid is still better. My opinion, but I enjoyed the discussion. Yogi. What could go wrong here?
That's good. right into freaking like wet, greasy towels. I wish if I wasn't on 2 hours sleep, I would.
Karate Kid after this, yeah. I may be doing Karate Kid in June though, guys, for its 40th anniversary. So I've been thinking about it. So, and I'm a mood guy. If I'm not in the mood for it, I don't want to sit here and really talk about it. This is the last episode for the Man in the Movie Watch Party series, but I'm doing a Predator watch along series in June, starting in June. So we're going to go through every Predator movie.
Wow. It's a lot of movies. So,
my mom's hunting me down. Take me out. Oh, that would fuck your mind up, man.
For sure. His face. He's like, get her out of here.
Look at Christopher Lloyd's eyes. Look at this. His, yeah. The physicality of both these guys is funny.
But yeah. Yeah, she is Leah Thompson. I met Leah Thompson and I had her sign my Howard the Duck one sheet poster.
She's going to be at the convention in Niagara Falls.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
2 hour drive for me in June.
She's super nice, man. She's so nice.
I was wondering if I just should tell her, you know, this is my density. Well, I mean, my destiny.
She's so nice.
That's good. Like, there's going to be Dolph Lundgren had to cancel, or it says postponed. That's why I wanted to go in the first place. But they got like Robert Patrick's going to be there. Derek Mears is going to be there. Heather Langenkamp, she's going to be there. So I don't want
to
miss that.
You haven't been to a convention in a while. It's probably worth going.
I'm going to be a daddy-o.
Yeah. I say that to my son all the time. I'll say it to him and then he'll say it to me.
I love how Doc builds a complete model of the entire town and then apologizes how credit.
Yeah. He's like, I'm sorry I wasn't able to paint it. Like, he's just going to show him this one little thing and he wanted to paint the whole thing for him.
I even did a remix with Hunger City in there. Get your damn hands off her.
Should I swear?
God damn it, George, swear. See, I love how they're staging something to get his parents together and it happens naturally. Like, that's...
Sure.
That's the movie, man. Like, that's the
makes it work.
He brings his family together in a weird by going back in the past.
So and then when he sees him again, his dad's confident. He's got a lot of good stuff going for him.
Goes to show you that, you know, you let people walk over you when you're young. It haunts you. It could really haunt unless you take a stand sometime.
Yep.
And the movie's flying by too, man. Like,
oh yeah,
got a great pace to it.
Yeah.
If I'm meeting Dolph Lundgren, I'm definitely getting him to say good journey. Right. I remember seeing that movie in the theater when I was a kid, Masters of the Universe.
Oh, so good.
It also makes you find it odd that these two, an old scientist and a kid, like, how did they get together? And now you see this little time loop, right? Because he was probably looking out for it now, for this young kid. I always figured he was an ex-school high school teacher who got fired or something and and Marty
stayed friends with him or something.
Yeah, stayed friends with him. Like,
yeah, because they never really explained it, I guess, at the beginning, right? Like how he knew this guy.
That's just where my mind goes when I'm thinking about it. That's all.
Marty.
Maybe he fixed his skateboard. I don't know.
But then what's his name? Strickland knew about him, remember? He's not hanging around with that wacko.
That's why I think he was maybe fired. Maybe caught the lab on fire or something one time. I don't know. Who knows? Crispin Glover for the best Friday movie and final chapter. And straight to Back to the Future in 85. Incredible. And he still does stuff like Willard, and he did that Tim Burton one of Alice in Wonderland. He was in that.
Another cool one he did in it might have been 80s or 90s. What was it? It was one with like a bunch of other like teens too. It was Jesus, I forget now. I think there was like a dead body or something in it. But there was another one in the 80s he did that was a pretty good movie. Had a pretty all-star cast in it.
He was in Teachers with Ralph Macchio.
Oh, yeah. I forgot about that.
He was in that. He had a small role in that. This is so classic. The coming up, the Johnny V. Goode scene. Man.
Jeez, you smoke too? Oh, River's Edge. Yeah, MAGA. That's what I was talking about. River's Edge.
I don't think I've seen that one.
Cool movie. Huh? He's like, wait a minute. My mother lied to me. Said she never would park a car with a boy.
You drink too? Tim says, it's funny how you guys mentioned that about Doc and Marty. If they did a prequel, they would have to go back in time to explain how they met. Yeah.
For real. I love this. I love the whole band thing. I love when they do Earth Angel. That's a great song.
Yeah. The movie's just so well written.
Yeah. It's your cousin, Marvin Barry. You know that sound you were looking for? Uh-oh.
And without Marty's presence there, George wouldn't have the ball. George would have never had the balls to do what he does.
Yeah.
But like the son, like, inspired the father, and then the father inspires the son.
Michael J. Fox's expression when he turned over to see her and he saw her in that dress, he was like, oh, fuck, here we go. Like, awkward. So awkward.
Early morning, boys. Glad I hopped in. A lot of cool people in the chat. Night, fellas. Good night, dude. Night, Ronnie, man. I know. Right after this, I'll be going to bed, too. I got to wake up 5:30 in the morning. So. I'm a morning guy, though. So, it's like kissing my brother.
What time is it where you are? 10:45?
It's 10:42. Yeah, 10:45, something like that. Hey, Nick, what's going on, buddy? How you doing?
What up, Nick?
Push Horror Channel.
Sick. I love it. $100. This is rated PG, baby.
You could tell that's Alan Silvestri because the the cues almost sound like Predator. Like the dun-dun-dun. Yeah.
So read a PG movie and this guy's like about to rape her, basically. That's good. That's good.
Yeah, the ratings. It was
yeah, the ratings was a mess. What was the couple movies that got the rating system? Was it Temple of Doom was one, right? Gremlins and
Temple of Doom was, it's because it's dark. It's a dark movie.
Yeah. What was the other one that got them to switch? It was freaking
could have been Gremlins.
Gremlins and Red Dawn. Red Dawn is so freaking violent, man.
Like these Reefer guys are addict. In trouble. Reefer addicts. All smoking their dope.
Look at that car though. They've got so much shit piled in it. Like
how do they fit in it?
I sliced my hand.
Here comes George to the rescue.
I'd love to see a Gremlins 3 as long as it's not hacked to CGI bits. Look at that.
I'd like to see a darker version of Gremlins. Oh shit, it's Biff.
Yeah, like this is...
This is great. This is the character arc, man. See, the fact that he stood up for her and saved her.
Yep, it's great.
This change would change the way she feels about him. And instead of hitting, you know, she felt sorry for him. That's how they got. But this is like her knight in shining armor. Like, this is changes the game considerably. Yep. Yeah, all practical effects, I agree. For Gremlins 3. They should, anyway. There you go. Clock them. Fucking spun that dude right around.
Puts his hand out for
Oh, where's Marty from the Changed Future coming?
Yep.
Where's Marty watching Marty?
That's another thing in part two where they did all that splicey splice where he was in the scenes was wild the way they had to do all that.
That's great the way they did it. Damn, where is that kid?
Earth Angel. I love this.
The fact that he's just going through a simple chord progression, and that's impressive. Like, it's... Yeah.
It's like, no kid's not up like guitar nowadays.
It's freaking in the 80s. That's just...
That's standard.
Basic, like standard music. Yeah. Freaking 101 guitar playing what he's
maybe
doing.
Maybe back in the 50s, like, nobody knew guitar ever, like, but anybody, like, barely. Oh, this is... what's his name? Is this the dude from... Burbs? Is this him?
If Mel is watching or she watches this, I'm another one who hasn't seen the Burbs.
Oh, dude, it's so good.
I know she was teasing Fauci about that, but Fauci hasn't seen anything, so I got one up on that. I can have a pass.
Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, see you later, dude. Thank you for dropping in and keeping the chats going engaged. George! I like this. I like how he pushes this guy with just one hand.
Yeah, and the guy falls right on his back. George is so strong now.
George is Superman now.
Whoa! And then Marty comes up. That's so good. I can play. And he's like,
I'm not going to die now. I was born.
He's like showing him.
Let's do something that really cooks now.
Really cooks. Your kids are going to love it.
I know, Tim. I know. I haven't seen it. Fuck.
The Burbs is one of the best. You'll love it, man. It's so memorable. So many one-liners. I met Michael J. Fox, and some dude that was in front of me in line had him sign a guitar replica of that guitar.
Nice.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. B Maggie, you gotta go subscribe to the Rad Pack podcast on YouTube. We did a watch along for the Burbs like 2 months ago. Me, Mel, and Justin the Slacker.
I don't know how you guys do both your own channels and that. That's
it's hard, man. It really is hard.
It's tough. I mean, I can do like little series here and there with other people, but
you know, the Rad Pack podcast would be growing faster, but it's hard for us to put a lot of time into it, you know, because we're so focused on our own thing. Yeah.
Well, that's the thing. Like, and finding people who are just as committed as you are, that's the tough part. Like,
yeah, for real.
I mean, I love the people I work with, but to have the dedication, the commitment of someone like me, that's tough, man.
I hear you for sure. Well, Justin's been slacking on videos and stuff. He hasn't posted a video since I think like October. But he had a video go viral. So like he's gained like 3,000 subs on one video. So he hasn't done anything else. He's just riding that video as long as he can.
Oh, I planned my whole year out last year.
Oh, me too.
So
I basically do it month by month. I'll plan out. Yeah.
Yeah. So April, I got the Planet of the Apes. And then in May, I'm doing like 80 slashers. June, I'm doing blockbusters like E.T., nice. Back to the Future, T2, Independence Day, probably like summer blockbusters. Like I have a little theme.
Rad Pack too. We have to have it every month on. But that's the way to do it, man, because it keeps you on track, you know.
And I want to just that's funny, man. That's funny. I just thought that would be, it keeps me focused.
Yeah, for sure.
And obviously I throw things in there now, like a review of this or review of that. Like, cause a lot of action movies have built my channel. So I like to throw a Stallone thing in there, an Arnold thing in there while I'm doing other stuff, just cause those are my loyal followers. That's what they came to me for. And I love that stuff. So
yeah.
I would love to see both of you do a Spielberg ranking. Oh, maybe Garrett and I will talk about it. Maybe we'll do a live stream.
Oh, man.
Question. Would you rather have a DeLorean be able to time travel or any one of the Batmobiles with Batsuit and gadgets? I want a time
probably
travel.
Say the time machine, yeah. The DeLorean. It's a good question, man. It's probably like, this kid's weird. George is like, what's that dude's deal?
Marty, that's a nice name.
So when they have kids, she's like, I think I want to name him Marty, that kid that I used to like in high school.
Well, if you think about it, from Lorraine and George's perspective, time goes by, and they would probably have the odd conversation of, do you remember that guy,
yeah,
kid from high school that sure was only there a few days? And
a few days.
Like,
he showed up for a few days and like totally got us together. Remember him? For no reason.
And then all of a sudden our son looks like him. It's kind of weird.
Yeah. If I was George, I'd question it. I'd look at Lorraine and be like, oh, dude, you haven't seen that Marty guy anytime soon recently, have you? No. Why does our kid look just like him?
I like how Doc knows what's happening. Like, he's like, oh shit, that's going to change everything in the future because of that. Like, he suspects. I think he theorizes it. That's my anniversary, October 26th.
Are you serious? Look at that, huh?
I didn't realize that. That was the day he went back. Who knew I was going to get married?
I know. Then if you had the time machine, Marty McFly went back. You could go back to when you could get engaged. Yeah.
That was like 17 years ago, 16, 17 years ago. I got married. So.
DeLorean or Millennium Falcon? I still do DeLorean, but maybe you have.
Oh, other. DeLorean. Yeah. See, Doc's stunned. He doesn't realize what Marty means to him. Like, really has the themes of friendship, doesn't it?
Yeah. Which I feel like sometimes you don't get that nowadays, like to that deep.
A family adventure movie, really. Fun for the whole family.
Like, I feel you don't get like a lot of friendships that seem that deep anymore. Everything is just very like fly by night, like.
Yeah, I agree.
get a DeLorean and crash Jason's wedding.
Yeah. Please don't. I ripped my wife's wedding dress when we were walking, because the guys put a ball and chain around me, and I started running from them. I'm in my tux and everything. I start running from them because I thought, this is going to piss my wife off. I just got married. But it was her idea, and I didn't know that. And then we bumped into each other when we did it, and I ripped the back of her dress. So her aunt was stitching her in, and she was so upset.
If you had a time machine, you could go back in time and make sure you didn't do that.
Perhaps.
It would have changed everything.
Jurassic Park is my favorite movie of all time. It came out June 11th, 93. My son was born June 11th, 2018. He loves dinosaurs. What are the odds?
That's cool.
I love Jurassic Park.
I remember seeing Jurassic Park in theaters when it first came out as well.
I went three times.
Wow. It was mind blowing at that time. It was unbelievable. Like, you've never seen anything like that before. I was completely blown away.
Yeah. You know, Avatar was a really good experience.
I've seen it
in theaters,
but
that was the only 3D movie that was actually really good 3D. Where you felt immersed in the world, like,
yeah.
I I guess 20 years from now, maybe not even that far away, you'll be able to go into a virtual world when you're watching the movie.
Wow.
So you feel like you're actually a fly on the wall.
It'd be
if that makes sense.
Yeah, I mean, I've never done any kind of virtual reality stuff, so I'm still so so confused on how that would feel or look or.
Or maybe, well, you'd smell and you'd feel everything. I think that's
wild.
I mean, where do we go from the movie theater now? Like, what's the next step, right?
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, you're already in high def everything, 4K. What's next? Yeah, I think you'd have to send it to the virtual world now.
It's just so far crazy. Like, it's hard to even fathom, I think.
Like, could you imagine watching Friday the 13th Part 2, right? And Paul's around the campfire, and you're sitting there behind them.
I can't. I mean, like, I would think it'd be amazing, but I can't even imagine like what that would look or feel like. Like, I have no concept of that, you know.
Because it's just brain stimulation.
it's like, to me, I feel like if they could figure things out, that like the world in 20 years is going to be like Ready Player One or something. Where everybody's just going to be in headsets in like a whole different world all the time. And like, you know, where you live can be just like garbage. As long as you're rich inside your fake world, then you're golden, you know?
Yeah.
I've never tried VR. So that's crazy.
Yeah, I haven't either, actually. I'm just saying it'd be cool if you could, it'd be cool if they could take the old movies we love like this and do VR with it where we could be in the world.
You could be in the car right now next to him or whatever.
Or something like that. Like,
I mean, imagine being in this car next to him and being like, slow down. Cause you feel like you're going like 88 miles per hour down like a side road or something. And there's nothing.
Or watching a horror movie, but you actually feel the wind. You feel the atmosphere. Like, you get chills because you're outside at Crystal Lake or.
It would be crazy seeing Jason coming like right towards you, but he's really going like next to you to the girl. But you have to like kind of get out of the way.
Yeah.
Like, the movie never changes, but you kind of look at it differently.
Yeah.
Because now you're right there.
I mean, I would be down for it.
I'd be interested in it for sure. I mean, people have anxiety now. Imagine being in like a horror movie on a VR and like freaking out every night, time you watch a damn.
Like, imagine a Texas Chainsaw VR, like the original movie, right?
Then you get out of it and you have nightmares for like weeks.
Yeah. I just think that's the next step in entertainment. Like,
I don't even know what's
I mean, they're doing it with the games, right? They're doing it with games. There's a story and everything, apparently. So,
yeah,
I'm just wondering if you could do that. I'm just wondering if you could do it with a movie. You could experience the movie by going into its world. That would be epic for movies. Basically creates a giant screen so it feels like you're in a movie theater. Yeah, like. Oh shit, it doesn't fit. The tree branch.
It cuts it so close. Wow, he said Resident Evil VR is terrifying. Wow. Interesting.
I can imagine.
Cutting it so close.
Yeah, building the suspense so good. I mean, you know he's going to go back, you know, to his time, but it's how they execute that plan. It's how they execute how they do that. Imagine playing Friday the 13th as Jason, but in VR, and you're looking through the hockey mask.
That would be crazy, right?
Here comes Marty around the corner. I'm back. I'm back from the future. Well, you know, in the second movie, they allude to it. Jaws 27 or whatever, and the shark comes up like a hologram.
I still want that.
He did it, Doc.
Doc. I love how the 80s, like back then, felt so kind of dirty, like kind of grimy.
Gritty.
Like
everything was gritty back in the 80s.
Yeah.
Tim says, I played the Creed boxing game on the VR. It was crazy how real it seemed.
Cool.
Yeah,
that's insane.
That'd be pretty cool. Oh, it's an ice box again.
X-rated movie theaters. Just out in the open, like nothing.
I love this, man. The car stops now, and he's he keeps you on the edge of your seat, right?
Now you're like, oh, I know where they're going. The Libyans. No. Bastards.
Yeah, it is called Lone Pine Mall now, not Twin Pine Mall.
Yep. Because he hit the damn tree with the car. So I see, like, everything's great how it plays out, you know?
Revenge of the Nerds watch party. I love that movie.
I'll
think about it, guys. I'll take any suggestions, really. I probably won't be doing any watch parties for a while. If I say that, then, like, next week, you never know what happens. Lone Pine Mall, there it is.
I love this, like, different angles and stuff, like...
Yeah. It'd be weird watching yourself. It's like a movie.
I mean, do you think that they redid this scene for this part, or do you think they filmed it in two different angles and then used the footage later?
I think they filmed it at the same time.
Yeah.
Right? I would think, typically in movies, wherever their location is, they film all those scenes at once. Like,
they
would film all these at once. They'd film everything in the house at once.
I mean, they'd have to probably film that from all angles. Like, how many times are they going to be like, oh, run into that thing again. All right, rebuild it. Run it into it.
Tim says, yeah, you start at the Front Street gym, walk in, and Rocky is standing there. And I was like, yo, Rock. Yeah, that'd be cool, man.
Wow, that's
like, that's
cool,
what
man.
I'm talking about. Like, being able to walk the streets with Rocky, like, if you're going to a VR world. Porky's watch party. Oh no, I'll cry too much. That movie's hilarious. Bulletproof vest.
How did you know? He like taped it up.
Look how old the letter is now. It's great. Lou's Cafe.
Yeah. Doc, got the car working? Oh. Oh, Friends. Remember they even did a cartoon with them two, like a team or whatever? And even like, what's that show now that people like? It's basically just them two, right?
Oh, yeah. Rick and Morty. Yeah.
Yeah.
I used to watch the Back to the Future cartoon all the time.
Oh, yeah. Me too.
And Ghostbusters.
Oh, hell yeah. That was like my favorite cartoon. I'm starting to show my son that real Ghostbusters cartoon. Everything's changed.
2015?
I know.
It's almost a decade ago.
That's fucking crazy. I can remember when that all hit and everybody was going nuts because it was like, finally we're at 2015 and, you know, there's no flying cars and all this stuff.
It's not that we can't have that. It says that there's just too much greed and there's too much...
Imagine that, though, like trying to figure that whole thing out, flying cars with like lanes and people just not flying all over the place.
I mean, the wife got me a new car two years ago now. I've had it for a couple years, and there's a feature. As long as you have lanes on the highway.
Oh, yeah. Like
It will correct itself, and it works. That's what's crazy.
Scary.
Like, I'm like.
Gary.
It's like his house. He's like, what the hell is this?
Yeah. What the hell is this? It's great. All 80s out, like really fancy 80s stuff.
Forbes magazine.
Breakfast. I always wear a suit to the office. I had those same chairs in my house growing up. My parents had it with like the wicker back with the metal springy like legs.
Look the way they're acting. They're completely different with each other.
Yeah. Oh, I like her. Wrecked.
Biff's bitch. It's great.
I'm sorry, Mr. McFly.
Such a great ending.
Marty gets like no credit. He's like a wicked goofball. Hi, Marty. Yeah. He's so over the top goofy Biff now. He's like so lame.
He got put in his place.
Look at that. He's got that. Check out that 4x4. That is hot.
You know, you don't even realize it's like when Elizabeth Shue recreates the scene.
Yeah.
It's such a great transition. You forget that.
I've seen a shot for shot like comparison. He had to redo the whole scene, and it's really cool how he did it. I agree, B-Mag. I'd take that truck over a brand new pickup truck any day with all those lights and stuff on it.
Oh, there's our ending.
His Bret Hart glasses on. Come on, you got to be a Bret Hart guy, right?
Yeah.
All right, good.
I like Bret Hart back in the day. I don't really watch wrestling, but I did when I was a kid, though.
Was he like a god over there in Canada or what?
Oh, yeah, he was pretty popular. I was actually always an Ultimate Warrior fan.
So was
like, when I was a kid, he was my guy.
Me too.
Puts beer in it.
Some kind of asshole or something? Rhodes. What a great ending. Like, so that's what you wonder. Was it just like a you imagine the ending, or at this point were they like, there's definitely going to be a sequel?
No, I think it was just they wanted to leave it ambiguous to your imagination, I guess.
Then after they did that, they had to be like, well, I guess we got to really make a sequel, go into the future now and find his kids, right?
Yeah. But to be honest with you, as much as I like the, as much as I do like the sequels, I kind of like, it's once I watch this, I don't go, I need to watch two now. I need to watch three. I think the movie stands on its own so well, as just the same.
No, it was good to watch it again, man. Discuss it.
Classic.
It's one of the all-time best, I think, in my opinion. It's just a masterpiece. Oh, yeah. There's not many movies that come out that just work that well. And like we talked about before,
yeah,
everything in the movie means something later in the movie and all that stuff. It's just, it was just really well done. And I agree, Tim. Attitude Era was fun. 40 was a great mania. It's been the best in a long time.
Yeah, I mean, these movies are just, everything has a purpose. Every character has an arc.
And for a movie that took place technically in the 50s and the 80s, I still feel like this movie feels timeless too.
Yeah,
even though it like really does set itself in like way in the past, you know?
Yeah, there's the odd movie that you could say, oh, this movie is so timeless. And it's so true. This movie is timeless. It's just one of those things that where you'll get some 80s movies where you're like, oh, this movie is, this feels in like the 80s, right?
Like
it's like The Crow, right? The Crow feels really 90s.
It does.
It's such a 90s. It's such a 90s gothic dark film, but it feels 90s. Like you watch that movie and it's just like, oh yeah, this is so 90s.
Yep. 100%. Same with like, I talked about this Brain Scan. I don't know if you ever saw that one, but that feels very 90s, but in a good way. Like brings you back to, like we said, when in the 90s, I was more like a preteen and teenager. So brings me back to like when you're starting to feel a little more independent. You have your own room with like a nice little setup. You have friends over, you're hanging out and playing. And
yeah,
the internet was just getting started and you were kind of messing around on there, kind of see like what where was going they, on.
Where they made the mistake about generally speaking anyway, is that the 2010, it was the remake decade. So it doesn't have its own identity. It
so
doesn't
that's
feel
what's
like
funny
it anyway.
I'm going through the 2000s on my channel right now when it comes to horror, and like I just started from 2000 2001, and it's like a weird post Scream, we're not really sure where we're going era. And then as we get into the 2002 2003, we start to see the remakes poke their head in and stuff. So and that lasts for a majority of the 2000s.
Tim says, wicked awesome movie tonight, this was awesome, thanks guys. No worries. Thank you, man. Tim. Yeah, this is a movie that should never be remade. Yeah, they seem to want to remake the classics, but they don't want to remake the movies that had cool concepts that were just executed poorly.
Yeah, it's weird. I don't get. Like, I am intrigued if they ever made a new one, like, but do it in like now and then 30 years ago, like we talked about 94 to now, and like having a kid go back. But I don't think you can ever compare it to this, nor it would ever be as clever as this or could touch this. But I think it would be interesting to see, like, take a kid of now. Who's the kid they keep saying is going to be the new Marty? What's his name? Is it the kid who played Spider-Man, maybe?
Oh, I've heard that. I think those are just...
But I'm saying, like, but again, that could be a character they could do this with, maybe. I don't know. How old is that kid, you think, now?
Oh, he's in his 20s now. But
so they could play him off as, like, a 16-year-old or something?
Maybe, yeah.
Tom Holland, and have him go back to the 90s and try to survive as like a teenager of the 2000s. It would be funny.
Yeah, like he would, they would have to be playing into social media too, how so sure. There was none.
Right.
And that would be an interesting route.
I agree, for real.
I don't know. You still do the angle of the... You still do the angle...
Probably, I think so. I would hope so, because I think it's just a cool concept. But yeah, like trying to figure out how to get them together, utilizing things like the computer, right? Like it could be anything. Yep. It could be so different.
It could be very different. Different enough that it could be something they could toy with, but I don't know. I mean...
But if they do it, they could even make it like I wouldn't try to make it a remake. I'd almost make it like a spinoff, like Back to the Future, like, and then have like a subtitle or something, so it doesn't get mixed into like they were trying to, you know, take over where this one was and all that other stuff, because that's where it gets confusing. It's like they try to start something new, and sometimes I feel like I hate when franchises try to almost make you forget about the originals.
Yeah,
but we'll see. I mean, it's such a classic. I'd hate to have it remade, but I think the concept can really work. Just to see what the differences are from the 90s to now, if they can really bring it back. I mean, they really brought back what the 50s felt like to me. So it'd be interesting to see how they could do it.
Yeah. And also, I'm just assuming that the Cobra Kai guys wanted to do some kind of bringing Marty back, bringing Doc back, and maybe Marty's kids or something, or maybe that's who it's, you know what I mean?
Hey, like, I mean, maybe they do something with them, and all of a sudden, like, Tom Holland's Michael J. Fox's kid, and, like, that's how he had the DeLorean, and then, you know what I mean? Like, yeah. They could add all that kind of stuff in.
And or the...
legacy sequel.
Or the kids, you know, the same idea. The kids end up changing the timeline, and everything Marty did got undone,
sure.
Let's say, and they have to... fix it or something like that. I think that would be a better route to go.
I mean, I think as long as you got the right people behind it, I think that there's always a possibility for success. Like you said, there's no reason Cobra Kai should have been as good as it was. I know a lot of people don't agree with me like on this totally, but I thought Afterlife did pretty good job.
I liked it.
Ghostbusters. I think it. I mean, God, when you have 40-year-old men in a theater, almost in tears. You had to say you did something right, because, you know, that was a pretty emotional ending, you know, with Harold and all that stuff. So
I don't know. Tim says we need an Uncle Buck watch party. Yes. Yes. I love John Candy. And B Magnus, Mega123 says we need John Hughes ranking September. I'm reviewing John Hughes movies in September. So I told you, I got the year planned.
That's so funny.
I've already done Planes, Trains, and Automobiles, but I'll be doing Weird Science and Ferris Bueller and all that kind of stuff. So
nice.
Tim says, I agree with you. That's why Cobra Kai works so well. They did a spinoff, almost sequel-like. They never tried to make it a remake. Yeah, and right. they took a villain who was the villain, and you made sense of him, made him tick, and... And how far you know he hit the dumps. And it's really about Johnny coming to terms and his character arc, which is great. You know, I like that. I like when they take characters like that. See, that was the way to do a legacy character, and they redefined them and they recreated them. You know what I mean?
Yeah. You know what else is cool about Cobra Kai is, like, we didn't know a lot about it when it came out. We weren't sure. Like, a part of me was like, oh my God, is it going to be like Fuller House? Like, that's what I felt going into it. It's going to be almost like a mockery of itself, kind of. It wasn't going to take itself serious. But then when I watched it, I was like, holy shit. And then I remember going through the first season and not really knowing anything. And all of a sudden you get to the last episode and the season ends. And all of a sudden you get the shadow of, like, John Kreese lighting up the cigar. And I was like, you know, because you weren't expecting, like, that they were going to go all out with, like, all these characters. And all of a sudden now you're like, oh my God, it's a, you know, we're going into season two and they just introduced John Kreese. Like, this is insane. You know, I think it was really well done. Bringing some of these legacy characters back in at the right time and not just kind of making it just like a free for all. Like, everybody kind of had a purpose.
You know, I think that's where I have this pitch. I didn't do a video on it, but I have this pitch. You got a Cobra Kai Rocky. I thought, why not take, are you familiar with Rocky One?
Of course. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So you remember the Dipper Brown, the one who stole Rocky's locker? So he's like, Mickey was training him.
Okay, yeah.
And then he says, you know, you're a tomato rock. And he says, why did I get thrown out of my locker? Dipper needed it. That, anyways, you could make Dipper this old, crusty, you know, you stole my trainer away from me, rock. And you could have them running their own boxing gyms with kids.
Oh, so like you're saying, like, do a similar thing from Cobra Kai, but have it more of, like, for Rocky movies.
Do the Rocky, because Stallone's old now, and why can't he train, like, 10-year-olds and 12 kind of thing? And just, I thought, it's kind of Cobra Kai, but maybe that's where you take it now. Like, I just think that'd be a cool idea.
I'm sure Stallone would be all about it. He wants to keep that thing going as much as he can, you know?
And then you could have, like, an ultimate, like, boxing match, but like a tournament between both gyms. Like one's maybe South Philly and one's North Philly, and they kind of do this little competition, but tie it back to, and then you could start bringing, you could bring Mr. T back in some way. You could bring anybody who's alive anyway. So, yeah. I mean, I don't know. I always I always thought that would be a cool place to take Rocky.
You don't know anything about the new Karate Kid movie, do you? Because I'm here, like, I'm not sure what to think of it, and people are saying it's supposed to be canon to the show and everything else, but I'm like, how do they get there? How do we get to where we're going? It's going to be interesting. I'm hoping that they don't ignore the show. I think that'll be a big mistake, but I just don't know how you keep this in line with
everything. Obviously, Jackie Chan's playing a whole new character.
I don't know. Somebody said that he thinks that he's playing Mr. Han from the remake. Sorry. So I don't know how you connect the dots here. I really don't.
Well, then they're saying that that's not a remake. They're saying Mr. Han's actually just a similar Miyagi character.
Correct. Yeah. So the remake the remake won't technically be a remake. It'll be just another story from Japan with a similar concept. So Mr. Han would be another guy.
I don't know who's behind it. You know,
I think Machio.
No, like the director, though. Like, the
I don't know, but I know Machio is like part. He's got a big hand in the whole thing. So,
I don't know, so, man. I really don't know. I don't know what to think. It's Karate Kids. Is this back in style now? That's the thing. So they're soaking it. They want to make sure it's.
But I'm thinking, how does Daniel and Mr. Han get together and then meet a new kid that they train, like, and then all these other kids, part of Miyagi-Do and stuff, are just left behind.
But is Cobra Kai canon with this?
It's supposed to be. That's what I heard. I don't know for a fact, but that's what people in my chat were telling me when I was discussing it. They said, the writer said it was supposed to be canon to the show as well. But it's, I mean, I hope it is. Cause I mean, to just have a standalone with like Ralph, I don't know. I just feel like it's, I don't know how it's going to work. Because you're so invested in that character in the show, it's
you know
be
what
hard to
I always play. Say. I always say I don't like to see anything until I see a trailer.
Sure,
I don't. It's like that. Everyone was talking about Alien Romulus. Once we got the teaser, I went, I get it.
Yeah, a lot of people told me it was going to be awful, and I thought it was going to be awful because I didn't like the last one. I was like, I'm kind of done with aliens now. And then when I saw the trailer, I said, wow, this actually looks pretty damn scary. Like.
Yeah, it might be. It might be good. We don't know yet. Like,
right.
It's like anything. I got to see a teaser. I got to see what their tone is, what they're going for, before I judge anything. Like, I don't debunk anything. I don't hate on anything until I was even giving Dial of Destiny a fair shake, but when I saw it, I was like, this is not my Indiana Jones. Mm-hmm. Which, if you go through the series. It'd be interesting to see your perspective on it, but
sure, I should do it this year. So,
it's a lot of fun, but it's a fun series. Like I do like Indiana Jones. It's I mean Harrison Ford was here's another guy who was the man in the 80s.
Mm-hmm. Tons of people: Tom Selleck, Burt Reynolds. These are all people that were big names in the 80s, right?
Yeah. Very, very much so. But anyways, guys, I got to get going. Thank you, Garrett, for coming on.
You're welcome, man. It'd
be great to get together again with you at some point. I don't know. Do something. Movie talk.
Yeah, man,
talk,
for sure.
Whatever have you.
I know you had mentioned trying to get the whole Rad Pack on here at some point, so we can definitely work on something like that once schedules start to clear up and whatnot. So, yeah, I'm totally interested.
I'll,
for sure.
July and August, I have I can make myself very available at any time. So
okay,
maybe we can do something. I don't know.
Yeah, just keep in touch, and I'll see what the other crew members are up to this summer, and we can hopefully make something work.
Yeah, for sure. It would have been fun to have us all doing this, but you know, this was fun enough, and good insight and everything on one of our favorite movies. It's definitely one of my favorite movies of all time.
Same.
So yeah, let's maybe get this last two comments here, and we can get out of here. Later, yep. Fellas. Says thank you for being so active in the chat. It really helps.
Yeah, thank you guys. And Tim, I'm a huge 80s guy, and I've never seen any Indiana Jones. It's actually a running joke on my channel is that I've never seen any of them. So I'm hoping that this year is going to be the year that I finally watch them, because I did buy all the 4Ks with the intent of doing like a first time watch review. So it should be interesting.
Yeah, I would really like to see your thoughts on that. See what you think.
Especially going into 2024 and seeing if it holds up. I mean, I'm sure as a kid, I would have been over the moon about it, but
yeah. But anyways, everyone, you guys take care of yourselves and check out Garrett's channel. Everything he does over there. He's got a great channel. Great dude. Everything. You guys will be engaged, entertained. Check out the Rad Pack, too, and all that kind of stuff. And, yeah, you guys all have a good night, and see you in the movies, like always.